So, good afternoon or good morning or good night, depending on where you're located. So, welcome to the final webinar of this year. It's the last one, but it's a very important webinar because we are very happy to have Emilia Friedman with us. Welcome, Emilia. So, everyone knows Emilia for lifelong contributions to the domain, and she's author of a lot of papers and many influential papers that are highly cited. She's also author of two books, active in the community, in a lot of editorial boards. She's also currently a member of the IFAC Council. And several awards include, she's fellow of IEEE, and recently she obtained had the Lifetime Achievement Award on Time Delay Systems for her lifelong efforts to our community and contributions. And she also won a very prestigious research award at her university, Tel Aviv University. So, Emily, we're very happy to have you here. Please go ahead. So today, Emilia will talk about, will share her thoughts and talk about her contributions on using delays for control.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So maybe before Emilia starts, so I suggest that all questions are asked after the talk. So feel free then after the talk to take the word, or you can also put meanwhile questions and comments in the chat. So I will monitor the chat meanwhile.
Okay, thank you very much, Wim, for invitation and introduction. I will talk today about using delay for control. And here I mean either time delay approaches to control. I will present the old one, a time delay approach to sample data control, and I'll finish with a very new one, a time delay approach to averaging. And I will talk also about using artificial delay for control instead of using observer-based design. So, first, sample data control. So, it is very important today. Control systems use digital control, and I consider this simple LTI system and static output feed, state feedback case where sampling may be variable but upper bounded and close, and the implementation via zero or the whole device. So the closed loop system has such a form, and the classical approach to this was discretization, but this loses knowledge about intersampling behavior. For instance, for performance analysis, for H-infinity analysis, you need already some special tools and also system uncertainties, non-linearities, everything becomes difficult. And not to lose anything between the sampling instance, two other approaches were introduced, and particularly time delay approach and impassive or hybrid system approach. So the time delay approach includes two steps. First, modeling of the closed loop as system with delay, and the second one is appropriate stability performance analysis design, and this is in my case Lyapunov method. So the first step to modeling the sample data system as system with a special delay. Here, delay is t minus dk. And so this is the so-called Sawtooth delay. It is discontinuous and with derivative equals one almost everywhere. And so the first step we preserve continuous dynamic but with discontinuous delay was suggested in my Russian period, and here we used asymptotic methods, but in order to have an efficient upper bound on the sampling interval, we have applied much later with Alex Surianch and Pierre-Richard Lyapunov method by using Lyapunov functionals from our previous paper with Orishaket for systems with fast Varenne delays. What is fast Varenne delays? When we have no any assumptions about delay derivative. And all methods and effects of delays on stability and performance I illustrate by dances, which is my hobby. I will not show here a video because of internet and network induced delays, but this illustration I found rather recently for time delay approach to sample data, and it is slow, folks. What is special in this dance that we have discrete steps, discrete time updates, but dynamics should be very continuous. And this is what we have in time delay approach to sample data. And now the second step of the Lyapunov method, how does it work? Of course, this is well known, but I will remind you. So if we have a linear system with fast Varenne delay, we can we assume that without delay it is exponentially stable, a plus a1 is Hurwitz. And then we can present the delay term as the non-delayed one and disturbance. And this is our presentation of the closed loop system. Then in order to provide stability analysis, we first construct Lyapunov function which corresponds to nominal part and differentiate, and we have in order to arrive at V dot less than zero, which is feasible, we need to create minus quadratic terms like this. And to do this, we add such terms and create Lyapunov Krasovsky functionals. And this term after differentiation gives us a positive term. We have to pay something for the negative one, but this is exactly after using Jensen inequality gives us minus quadratic term. And for fast Varenne delay, all functionals which are known till now depend on x dot. And this is might be dangerous in some applications, for instance, for stochastic systems or in some kinds of PDEs, this should be modified very carefully if it is applicable at all. And to take a sawtooth delay into account, in my automatic paper, I considered such additional term instead of this one, which is good for fast Varenne delay, and it worked surprisingly good in some examples. But another option is why this is better, because when you differentiate it, you have the same negative term, but the positive term is smaller. Instead of upper bound, we have here tk plus 1 minus t, and together with descriptor method, it led to very efficient results. But another option is the so-called Wirtinger-based Lyapunov functional, which was introduced with my PhD student Kun Liu. And here, why it is Wirtinger-based? Because due to Wirtinger inequality, this term is non-negative. Here we have L2 norm of x dot, and here L2 norm of x, which is zero when supposed to be. Okay, and this functional leads to minimal LMIs, and it is efficient only also if we have additional constant delays, and particularly if we use predictor methods and compensate this constant delay for sample data control. This is still efficient, while the previous one not. And this is the simplest scalar example, for which the only example for which I know the analytical upper bound on time variant delay, which preserves stability. This is 1.5. By the way, sufficient conditions which guarantees this bound were obtained in Kalmanovsky and Mishkis by multiple use of resolution method. And now, how does this work in how LMIs, we have conditions in terms of LMIs, so the automatic analytical upper bound here too, which is far from 1.5, Wirtinger-based result gives 1.57, and it was inspired by Mirkin's work by using another approach. And this automatical paper gave exact result, which was surprising, and but it was still sufficient, and there are many improvements. And the same time delay approach is useful for networked control systems where we have plant and controller which exchange information through communication networks, and we have to take into account sampling intervals, network-induced delays, packet dropouts, quantization errors, and communication constraints. And whenever we have just without last feature, for instance, this is static output feedback with quantization and quantization error, the closed loop can be presented like this with sawtooth delay, but now this sawtooth delay includes also network-induced delay and delays due to packet dropouts, and omega is quantization error. And here we, since our Lyapunov method provides ISS bounds, we have done constructive dynamic quantization following Lieberson ideas with zoom in and zoom out, which achieves asymptotic stability and not practical one. And here everything is based on bounds on solutions, and the first time interval where the system is open loop should be carefully taken into account. And in the presence of scheduling protocol, what does it mean? We have to choose, for instance, we have two sensor nodes, and we have to choose which one due to communication constraints. We can transmit only one measurement, which one to choose. And there are various scheduling protocols, and only time delay approach allows, of course, it should have advantages in large delays, and it allows large communication delays, which are larger than sampling intervals. And here for round robin protocol, where one measurement is sent after another, we use a model with multiple time delays. In other cases, we had also hybrid delay system, and it worked very nice. And we also have applied this time delay approach to decentralized control of large scale system with weak coupling, and each plant has its own network on communication protocol. And here we used the following construction of Lyapunov functional. Vj was constructed for each plant, and we had conditions for, let us say, for input to state stability with respect to neighbors that we have here. And our results were essentially, gave essentially larger allowable sampling intervals and allowed large communication delays. I just want to mention our recent results about delay compensation. And this was done with Yang Zhu, who was my postdoc, and you may remember him from Miroslav's presentation. He is co-author of Miroslav's book, so he is expert in backstepping predictor, and he has considered, so in the same large-scale system with large delays, constant path of delays and additional variable delays, he compared three main methods for delay compensation. The classical reduction approach with Arnstein transformation, backstepping approach, and sequential subpredictors, where what is subpredictor? It is a predictor of the future state, observer of the future state. And so in this particular application, it appeared that subpredictors allowed larger delays finally and delay uncertainty. And a few words about time delay network-based control of PDEs. Actually, for the last 10 years, I'm dealing with PDEs, but I have not much time to present this. So we have motivation for it, long distance control of chemical reactors, air polluted areas, or application to multi-agents is also can be provided by using PDEs. And what is special for PDEs that arbitrary small delays may destabilize the system. And that is why my objective was to develop robust with respect to delays control methods. And we have introduced the so-called special decomposition method with Blizhovsky, and more recent result model decomposition method. This is a classical method, but novelty here is finite dimensional observer-based control, which was done with my PhD student, Ramek Katz. And what was found that efficient tool for analysis of network-based control system was combination of Lyapunov functionals with Holonais inequality. Holonais inequality is actually extension of Razumihin method to exponential stability. So this is if V is a scalar positive function which is subject to such inequality, and delta zero dominates over delta one, which is also positive, then we have exponential stability. So just an advertisement, and you ISS Holonais inequality for piecewise continuous functions, which is appropriate for combination with, for instance, Wirtinger-based Lyapunov functional, which is discontinuous. Yes, this new Holonais inequality has appeared in our January paper in Automatica with Rania. And now, to conclude, this is a recent book with Kun Liu. He's now professor in BIT. This is my book, which also presents standalone approach to sample data, and see also our survey with Anton Silivanov, who was my postdoc and now in Sheffield, and he had nice results also on event-triggered control and for ODEs and for PDEs, so check this survey. And I continue with artificial delay for control. And so here, this is also an old, let us say, method that if you have the second order integrator and you have measurements of X only, then you cannot stabilize your system by using static output feedback control like this, but since the full state feedback can stabilize the system, we approximate Y dot by finite difference and finish up with static output feedback with delay. But for implementation, this is still not simple because we have to keep in the buffer all the measurements from yt minus h till yt. And in order to make it implementable, a static output feedback was presented for the same setup with successive sampling. And this was done, so simple conditions for this were presented for the first time in my papers with Leonid Shahid, and sample data implementation like this with Anton Spivanov. And there are, of course, this delayed static output feedback was started by Abdallah and co-authors, and there were many papers by Silvio and Bim and Sabin Manti and Karafilis. Many have done this, and this stabilizing delay in tango. This illustration I found actually 10 years ago. And why in tango? Because in tango, after pivot, you have to stop in order not to fly by inertia. And this stop is actually delay by using zero order hold, sample data delay by using zero order hold. And now what, so this stabilizing delay was started basically by frequency domain methods, but what are applicable LMI conditions by using discretized Lyapunov method or augmented Lyapunov functional, starting from the paper of Alex Surier and Fred Gaspol, but this leads to high order LMIs without feasibility guarantees. And our objective is simple and feasible, because all this method is because static output feedback is simple. So LMIs also should be simple and efficient. And how does it work? So I will come back to the case when without delay we have stability, and how we can treat this case by using Lyapunov method, Lyapunov-Krasovsky method. So One way I have already shown you, which leads to Lyapunov functionals, which depend on X dot, but and this is also applicable for fast Lorentz delay, but for constant delay, we can also use such presentation. This is the remainder term. And here we finish up with the so-called neutral type transformation. And this leads to functionals which depend on X. Of course, today, when you use Lyapunov functionals, you probably do not know the origin where they came from, but this is very important. And how, but how this is not applicable when A plus A1 is not fluid. So what to do for stabilizing delay? Actually, the same idea works. So let us consider this second order vector second order system. And we know that we assume that it is stabilizable by such state feedback. And then we approximate x2, which is x1 dot, like this. We use Taylor expansion of x1 t minus h. So actually, we use the same as in the previous method, but take just one more term in Taylor approximation, and then this is the remainder. And so we find the gains of such delayed controller from the equality of this with the state feedback, and then we have this relation, and the error of approximation is of the order of h square, which allows us to derive feasible and simple conditions. For instance, in order to compensate such a term in Lyapunov analysis, we use very similar construction just with square, because we have this term. And after differentiation, we have this term, which is upper bounded by Jensen inequality, and we have now quadratic terms that we needed to approximate. And there is another, the neutral type transformation also works here, and then we finish up with such neutral type system. By the way, the classical and in our first papers with Leonid Shahed, we also verify the stability of the difference equation. This equals zero. But later we understood that this is not needed because our Lyapunov functional was positive definite in this sense, and we just needed to verify this condition. And these are the simple LMIs, and how does it work? For instance, this is a simple example from Kegan-Gu, and here such a controller stabilizes this system, and from frequency domain analysis, it is known that for delays from this interval, we have stability. Without delay, there is no stability. And these are results and the number of decision variables in LMIs by discretized Lyapunov method, by Fourier certain, and by our method, essentially simpler. We prove that the conditions are always feasible for small enough h, and our results are slightly worse, but this is because of simplicity and guarantees of feasibility. And now this is Anton Selivanov, and with him we have made the next step by using successive sampling. We can do the same jobs of stabilization. So we consider such a system, and this is the desirable notations, romantic notations of Anton, desirable but not achievable, and we go on compromise here. And now, so we have y dot, which is approximated now by this finite difference, let us say discrete time finite difference. And we have also the same relation between gains here and derivative dependent control. And what is new here in the sample data case, we have to present this finite difference sampling in such a form. This is continuous finite difference and this one. And then our control law will be presented like the derivative dependent one. And these additional terms, this is the same as in our paper with Shahid, and this can be compensated by using appropriate terms similar to Pirtinger-based Lyapunov functionals. And this is the example. We consider now uncertain double integrator, and this is the full state feedback which stabilizes the system. And from LMS we found Anton found that H like this is maximum H for which LMS are feasible, and then he found these gains. So this is much simpler static output feedback comparatively to observer-based design in such case when we have uncertainty and sample data. And since we had direct Lyapunov method, so we have extended these results to sample data implementation of PID controller, inspired by a paper of Ramirez and Sabine Manzier. And we extended to high order derivatives and with Jin-Zheng to stochastic systems and multi-agents. And also this method was applied to non-linear control, homogeneity-based design with Denis Yefimov, and static sliding mode control with Hu and my brother, and robust adaptive stabilization by delay with Aronofsky and Yefimov. And now I'm starting the third part of my presentation, a time delay approach to averaging. So here the original, if in the sample data control it is very intuitive to present sampling as delays, here you will not see any delays. So motivation, for instance, the classical Stephenson-Kapitsa pendulum, inverted pendulum, which can be stabilized by vertical fast oscillations. And the stability analysis here is based on averaging. So brief history of averaging, And the first ideas has appeared already in the works of Lagrange, and Krylov and Bogolyubov developed the first systematic method for analysis, and the classical already background for asymptotic methods was due to Bogolyubov and Mitropolsky 60 years ago. And in control, of course, it was started by this Kapitsa, Pendulum, and many others. I just want to mention some important works with important theoretical tools for stability analysis, vibrational control by Mirkov and Billman with co-authors, and extremum seeking with seminal paper by Miroslav Kristich and Wenk. And also I would like to mention the solution to Brocket problem of static output feedback stabilization by using Farquharian gain, which was given by Moria and Isles and Mikkels, Nicholas, and Wood. And so this is, so the first way for static output feedback we have given by using stabilizing delay, and this is an alternative method, and for the, which is appropriate for other cases by using fast Farquharian gain. So the existing results on averaging are qualitative. The system is stable for small epsilon if the average system is stable. But how to find the upper bound on epsilon? It can be done till now by simulations. And for uncertain systems, this is not reliable. And our new time delay approach to averaging gives the first efficient quantitative bound on epsilon, making averaging based control reliable. Of course, it is very beginning, and as with delay dependent methods, there will be many improvements. I will try to show now videos. I hope I will succeed. Okay, share screen, and now where is it? So this is how it worked till now, because there are no guarantees on the on fast oscillations which preserves guarantees the stability. And now I will show how it will work if you apply the new method that I will present. This is to inspire you. And now we go back to my slides. So let us consider the linear fast var system with fast Varan coefficients. And A is continuous and one periodic. And this is average of A, which is supposed to be Hurwitz. And so under these conditions, the classical averaging method says, claims that our system is exponentially stable for small enough epsilon. This is due to Khalil theorem. So do you see any delays here, either in the system or in the averaging condition? No delays, right? But if you live most of your life with delay, you may see that we can integrate instead of integration a long period, we can integrate from t minus epsilon till t. We can find averaging like this of both sides. We can integrate both sides, and then we will finish up with neutral type system. So this part was done with my postdoc Jin Zheng. We considered in our paper, which appeared exactly 1 year ago in the sample ratio of Automatica, we consider such linear system, and we assumed A in our case is more general, not continuous, piecewise continuous, because we want to apply it to switch systems. And we assume that the average is Hurwitz up to some uncertainty. So actually A is not supposed to be periodic, but almost periodic. We told that this is almost periodic. And under this assumption, the average system is exponentially stable. And now we will integrate both paths as written here, and we use exactly the same presentation as we used for stabilizing delay. So this can be presented as derivative of x minus additional g term. And the right hand side, we can just add and subtract xt, and for this part, we will have average of this, and the remaining part, xs minus xt, is here. And what is important, that all these terms are of the order of epsilon, and this gives us hope that we can manage by using Lyapunov-Krasovsky, because the non-dominant part is exponentially stable by our assumption. So this is neutral type system where instead of x dot, we have this. And what is important that that if x is solution of the original system, then it is solution of the neutral type system. And stability of neutral type guarantees stability of the original system. And these are Lyapunov-Krasovsky constructions, very similar to what you have seen. What is important here, okay, we show here positivity, but when we apply this Lyapunov-Krasovsky and differentiate, we will have terms which depend on A of T, time varying terms, and then we need some accurate upper bounding, and this should be and will be improved, and this is the point why conservatism arises. And this is example from Khalil. So average, this is Kapitsa pendulum, and the average system here is Hurwitz if gamma square less than 0.5. And so by Khalil result, for small enough epsilon, the pendulum is stable in the vertical position. We have chosen these numbers, and we considered also decay rate, and we found upper bounds for epsilon, which are still implementable not far from the ones that were obtained from simulations, but realistic. And another example was switch systems. So we say beta epsilon seconds here and 1 minus beta epsilon here. Both systems are unstable, but their convex combination is curved, and that is why we can stabilize the system by fast switching. And from our LMIs, we got this value of epsilon. From simulation, it was huge, but it happens because from my experience with single epitope systems, we considered example where for all epsilon, the system may be stable, but our method works only for small epsilon. And this is a rather reasonable value. So since we have a great Lyapunov method, we have extended it to ISS stability, to systems with small time varying delays, and to persistently excited system. For instance, we have such a system with standard assumption for persistency of excitation, and then there exists for stability analysis either time varying Lyapunov function or non-quadratic Lyapunov function, but for ISS this didn't work, and we have time independent quadratic Lyapunov functional, which is applicable to ISS. And actually, in our very recent paper to L2 gain analysis, and this is neutral system after averaging and simple LMIs, which is always feasible if decay rate is like this and small enough epsilon and this quantity. And another application that was in principle in the same time as we worked on our first paper, and Romeo Ortega approached me on CDC 19 with such a problem in power system. He told me how to design U with delay in order to stabilize this system, and V is periodic voltage, and P is active power, and we want to achieve P star value, and U should be constant, asymptotically constant. And the idea was to present this as usual and then substitute this, and then to finish up with this system for the error. For small enough Ki, our method worked, and from LMIs we found Ki, which was good from our power electronic experts point of view. And another application that we have considered on time delay system workshop was to solution of Brockett's problem. This is the second order system that we want to stabilize by using static output feedback with fast varying delay. So we actually have found a quantitative bound on the frequency of oscillation, which was missing in the previous works. We considered this square wave jitter, and to this system we cannot directly apply our method because of 1 over epsilon. So we first employed coordinate transformation from vibrational control. And then our method worked surprisingly good with this upper bound on epsilon, which was rather close to the one from simulations. And finally, we have done the first step towards extremum seeking, and this is with Yang Shu, who is now in Zhejiang University and was my postdoc. And he has presented a brief history on this map. So starting from 22 and with a seminal paper by Miroslav, and then from local to semi-global by Australia colleagues, and deep brackets approach, and time rank parameter estimation. And so we have applied time delay approach to extremum seeking first, and then for simple data implementation with constant delay, we have done it together with Thiago Oliveira from Rio de Janeiro. And so here we considered just static map, quadratic map, and we want to design theta, which is so we want to achieve the extremum point and extremum value without complete knowledge of the map. We have just measurement of y, and our objective is to construct theta in such a way that this holds. And with our robust control, we can treat the case of uncertain extremum value, extremum point, and Hessian with some from some intervals. And this is the classical extreme gradient-based extremum seeking algorithm. Theta is a real state estimate of theta star. And so after some work, it can be presented like this. And this is the dominating term because others have average other fast terms have average zero, and the result by Miroslav claims that we practically achieve theta star by this algorithm with this error. This is ultimate bound. So if A is small enough and omega is large enough, this is qualitative bound. We can also have qualitative bound and quantitative bound. And this is what we have done in our first paper, which appears in January 22 issue. And what is challenging here, we have non-linearity here, and we don't linearize our system. We want to give reliable bounds on domain of attraction, on ultimate bound, and on epsilon star. And this is what we have done. So to have these bounds, we also need some bounds on the initial interval, because our model is works starting from epsilon. And from zero to epsilon, we still need some additional bounds. And our ultimate bound is of the order of epsilon. And we also considered another extremum seeking algorithm, bounded extremum seeking by Schenker and Christich, and also managed with it. So this is result in this scalar static map and two algorithms with various parameters A and K, and the results are here. So bounded extremum seeking works for any F, but gives, of course, smaller upper bounds on epsilon. And we had in our CDC paper, which will be presented next week, we have sample data extremum seeking with discontinuous jitter. So sampling is half of epsilon, and epsilon is the period of jitter. And here we, of course, applied both time delay methods. First, for sample data control, we presented overall delay, which is due to sampling and due to additional constant delay. And then we applied time delay approach to averaging. Note that in this case, usually Tiago told that he used averaging due to check Hale results, but Hale's results are appropriate for constant delay, and here we have discontinuous delay, so our method manages with this case, and I think I have to finish. So take care of delays by appropriate tools and use delays for reliable control. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much, Emilia, for this very nice talk.